Hello everyone. Welcome to your lecture on culture and mediation. This lecture is a part of your paper on media, culture and society. This lecture deals with one of the strategies of encoding in message transmission, which is mediation. In this, we will understand the meaning of the concept of mediation and the process of mediation as practiced by the media organizations. We will learn that media does not put before us the reality as it exists, rather it creates a version of reality taking into consideration the cultural codes of the society. We will discuss the different forms of mediation like structural mediation and cultural mediation and the issues associated with these forms. We will also discuss the concepts like framing that is done in the media representation of reality. It would help you critically analyze any of the media forms that you encounter in your everyday lives like television, cinema, news, etc. This module will make you understand the role of culture in mediation. Part 1. The concept of mediation. Let us first address the concept of mediation itself. In the commonsensical terms, mediation can be understood as to occupy a middle position, to act as an intermediary. Usually, we use this term in terms of conflict situation. We use the term mediator referring to any individual who mediates between conflicting parties with an aim to reconcile them. Everyday understanding of the term is based on the principle of harmony, where the resolution of differences is made possible through an intervention of an apparently third neutral person. However, in communication studies, it is mainly that media acts as a mediator, not necessarily between conflicting parties, but between the producer and consumers of media text and images. Mediation is then means of transmission, an agency or medium. Basically, it is the transmission of messages contained in a text and images through mediums of books, TV, radio, cinema, internet, etc. in order to convey a certain meaning. To think of it in terms of conflict situation, media creates a conflict situation through the images and within its framework also provides a resolution to the conflict. For example, if you analyze the crime series shown on television, such as these popular shows, at the end we find that the conflict is resolved through the police or through other bodies of state force. This creates a sense of belief in the legal system and the supremacy of law is upheld. The repetitiveness of such conflict resolution in media images creates a feeling of familiarity and predictability in the audience. The result is the reaffirmation of the established belief systems held by the society. Recap of part 1. Therefore, in this part, we learn that mediation in terms of communication studies means transmission of messages contained in text and images through the mediums of books, TV, radio, cinema, internet, etc. in order to convey a certain meaning to the society. Part 2. Mediation as a process. Now that we've discussed the concept of mediation, we need to understand mediation as a process. This is how the transmission of messages actually takes place. Mediation is a process of transformation in which things are given value and meaning. The media technologies provide the symbolic resources and tools for making sense of everyday life. There are various processes of mediations such as communication and meaning construction. It includes creation and dissemination of cultural symbols in social life. We as consumers of such media text and images creatively engage with the products of the media industry. For example, if you see an image of a cake and candles lit on it, what kinds of thoughts come to your mind? One can relate to some kind of celebration, maybe a birthday cake, an anniversary cake, or an office promotion. Here, the cake as an object carries a cultural meaning, that is, of an occasion or celebration. People can relate to it in different ways, which means it is contextual in nature. Similarly, when we see wedding rituals on television serials, depending on our cultural backgrounds, we identify with the rituals and consider it to be reality. Like the specificity of clothing, rituals, hymns, grandeur, etc. The makers of image working in the cinema and television industry make use of such objects, arts, and artifacts from real world and create cultural resemblance with which the audience identifies. Now, the question arises, how is it possible for the media to keep the audiences engaged with its images? And what strategies does it employ in order to persuade the audience to identify with its images? We will address these one after the other. However, to answer these questions, we need to understand the different forms of mediation, which are structural mediation and cultural mediation. Recap of part 2. We will begin with structural mediation, but before that, let us revise what we have learned till now, which is mediation as a process. Mediation as a process involves communication, that is, it facilitates transmission of messages from one to one and one to many. Second, meaning construction, that is the addition of value and meaning to media texts and images based on the cultural background of the audience. Now, let us study structural mediation. We will address the idea of structural mediation through our earlier questions, which is, how is it possible for media to keep the audience engaged through its images? Second, what strategies does it employ in order to persuade the audience to identify with these images? Raymond Williams provides an answer to these above questions through his notion of structure of feeling and planned flow. Let us know the process of mediation through the two concepts given by Williams. He draws our attention to the fact that one should interpret television as a text, as it would enable us to unravel the structure of television programs which resembles or corresponds to the structure of our everyday life. However, media texts are not reflection of reality. Rather, it creates a form of mediated reality. This is known as framing in media production. What is framing? It is where the producer of images selects what needs to be included and omitted in the representation of any story. The selection of images, William argues, is determined by a structure of feeling, that is, the creation of certain emotion feeling by carefully omitting and including parts of media text and images. For example, the media uses several techniques to create a feeling among the audience, like focusing on interpersonal conflicts, close-up of private feelings, etc. Such strategies collapses the contextual difference between the process of encoding and decoding, as it constrains both decoding and encoding. The result is the prevalence of dominant structure of feeling, which supports the interests of the producers of the media text and sets the limits on how an audience can interpret the television text. Purnima Mankekar, the author of the book Screening Culture and Viewing Politics, through her ethnographical study on the Indian women television viewers, demonstrates how participants in her study in Delhi identified with the female characteristics on television shows through what she calls bhav, feelings or emotions. They consider them to be real and related to the plight of the protagonists in the television series, to their personal problems. So, we got the answer to the first question, which was, how is it possible for the media to keep the audience engaged through its images? The answer is through the notion of structure of feeling. The media offers an alternative to the experience of everyday life through the identification with television film characters, through our engagements with the narratives of media texts, and our obsession with internet chatting. Now, let us move on to the second question. What strategies does media employ in order to persuade the audience to identify with its images? The answer lies in Williams' concept of flow. Television programs and their schedule of broadcasting are carefully planned to create a kind of sequence of flow without any interruptions. One may consider that television advertisements between programs are interruptions. William considers advertisements to be a part of the sequence of flow, as they are carefully placed by the producers of media image. Any advertisement on domestic appliances used by adults will be a kind of disruption to the flow. Therefore, such advertisements are neglected on cartoon channels. Such a planned flow is one of the defining characteristics of broadcasting, embodying the structure of feeling. Even in terms of timing of television programs, one can find a kind of flow or sequence in them. For example, if you observe the cartoon channels on television, the advertisements shown in between are all meant for children products, such as food, clothes, gadgets, anything related to children only. William stresses the need to analyze the structure of any program on television. He gives the blueprint of television news format as an example, where he argues that news follows a structural and linear pattern, which can be analyzed under four headings. Sequence, priorities, presentation, and visualization. Sequence. In the beginning of the news bulletin, there is always the news headlines followed by the detailing of the news. The linear pattern of the news presentation reveals the priorities given to the news items. It is generally the emphasis on the acts and words of political leaders, followed by the general local news. Presentation. There is an informal way of telling the news by the reporters from the field itself, which in a way tries to connect the audience to the place where the event takes place. Visualization. The televisual impression of seeing the events live and even edited versions makes the audience feel more connected to the event. Recap of structural mediation. Therefore, through Raymond Williams' notion of structure of feeling and planned flow, we understand the necessity of carefully analyzing the structuring and planning of broadcasting content. The concept of framing in news content explains the notion of structure of feeling. It is the process where the producer of the image selects what needs to be included and omitted in the representation of any story in order to create a certain emotion and feeling among the audience. The result is the prevalence of dominant structure of feeling, which supports the interests of the producers of the media text and sets a limit on how the audience is able to interpret the text. Television programs and their schedule of broadcasting are carefully planned to create a certain sequence of flow without any interruptions. However, William considers advertisement as a part of sequence of flow. The notion of flow is understood, according to Raymond Williams, is by the structure and linear pattern followed by news and can be analyzed under four headings of sequence, priorities, presentation, and visualization. Now let us discuss cultural mediation. Cultural mediation is one such activity in which rich and varied cultural heritage, art, craft, and one of the community of area is disseminated to a large community. Therefore, this form has certain advantages. The following can be seen as the advantages of cultural mediation. One such advantage of mediation has been interweaving of lived culture into media messages. Since the media has a wider reach, it has a potential to be the carrier of culture to a larger audience. Mediation is thus both technological and social. It is through media that the audiences come to know about others in different parts of the world. It means to transcend the distance and bridge the gap between two different cultures across the globe space. For example, when we see the live coverage of any event in some important part of the world, in our living room, like the finals of Barclays Premier League or a Coldplay concert, or when we receive the world political news over the internet, it gives us a sense of reality, denying both difference and distance. This is a result of globalization. But what is globalization? It is where there is a flow of information and media technologies and television programs. There is enough possibility of hybridity in these programs. William Mazzarella points out that there is a confrontation between global and the local. The global media has to adapt to the local cultural values in order to find an audience. He points out that the mediation precedes the arrival of media, as the local culture is already an outcome of social technologies of mediation. He cites an example of the Japanese TV series Ocean, which became a huge success in Iran because its values of perseverance and suffering resemble that of the Iranian cultural codes. Another study by Divya McMillan on the music channel Channel V, which is a creation of India's alternate to MTV channel, shows that the producers of the program did not want an all-English or an all-vernacular video jockey, as it would have not worked for the audience. Therefore, they went for a mixture of Hindi and English, or Hinglish, in order to make the channel popular. Language becomes quite important and crucial to the process, as it helps in fostering unity among the diverse communities. Evidences of globalization are not only seen in media products, but other cultural products too. This process of globalization, that is the assimilation of the elements of global and local culture to appeal to the audiences, shows how culture as a social process is continuously made and remade through the shifting of relations, practices, and technologies of mediation. Cultural mediation through radio, television, also provides a framework to the audience to develop national culture and public participation. We have seen the evidence for the same in history and propagandist measures employed by states in order to build the idea of nation. Another famous example is Benedict Anderson's Imagine Communities, where he relates the growth of nationalism with print media. Similarly, during Indian freedom struggle, newspapers played an important role in spreading the message of nationalism and freedom. In contemporary times, several social campaigns against injustices have been initiated through social media like Facebook, Twitter, and WhatsApp. Recap of cultural mediation. Let us quickly revise cultural mediation. Cultural mediation is one such activity in which rich and varied cultural heritage, art, and crafts of one community or area is disseminated to a larger community. It has many advantages, one of which is interweaving of lived culture into media images. Media is a carrier of culture to large audiences and is both technological and social. It fosters globalization and the new term glocalization, which is the assimilation of the elements of global and local culture to appeal to the audiences. Cultural mediation through radio and television also provides a framework to the audience to develop national culture and public participation. Which we saw in the case of world as well as Indian history, although we see the mediums changing in the contemporary times. Part 3. Mediation, reality, and politics of representation. According to Raymond Williams, mediation is an essential process of ideology as well. It relates to the question of who controls the media. Those controllers of media prevent and at the same time propagate the understanding of reality. He opines that both in public and private broadcasting, there have been rules that constrain the freedom of television. For example, a political leader or any person in position of power can put pressure on the individual stations to alter the news content. It implies that media has an unstable relationship with reality. To add to that, the boundaries between information and entertainment are blurred further through TV reality shows, news bulletins, and chat shows. Mediation is a shared activity which involves mutuality and reciprocality. It is not that the case that media imposes its view on us, rather we are in the position to have chosen it for ourselves. Media has a powerful discursive and ideological effect, therefore the neutrality of media turns into question the credibility of mediation. Recap. Raymond Williams suggested that mediation is an essential process of ideology as well, therefore the question of who controls the media arises. Those controllers of media prevent and at the same time propagate a certain understanding of reality, which results in an unstable relationship between media and reality. Boundaries between information and entertainment are further blurred through TV shows, news bulletins, and chat shows. With this explanation, I hope you have learned that mediation is understood as a process where there is a convergence of culture, society, and media technologies. It enables the process of communication and also that of creation of meaning. When we see the cultural codes that we use to make sense of our everyday lives on the television screen, we tend to relate to it. However, it runs the risk of promoting the dominant cultural values, serving the interests of a few sections of the society. The process of mediation becomes a successful project as the media technologies incorporate a structure and flow in their program, which are similar to the structure of our daily lives. We experience the lived reality, and the media presents before us a version of that reality. This is done to create and maintain audiences. However, one of the unresolved questions in the mediation is the authenticity of representation. What matters to us is not what the reality is, rather what is that counts for us as reality. For more details, please read the modules and e-text carefully and attempt the questions at the end. Thank you.